All right, so before we actually start with the menus for third year, we are going to show you a few garnishes. Okay, so let's begin with the first garnish, because garnishes are very important, play a very important role in the presentation of food. Okay, so we are going to show you a couple of garnishes which you can use as a part of your plate presentation. Okay, so let's begin with the first garnish, which is a tui.
So for the tui batter, we need to take 5 grams of flour. Now whenever you're measuring quantities, especially in weights, please use a digital weighing scale for the exact weight. So measure 5 grams of flour, which is around 2 teaspoons of flour, then about 5 ml of oil. So you can use any flavored oil. So here we are using plain refined oil. In that, we are going to add a little bit of salt for taste. You can also add any spice powder if you want for color and taste. Then we are going to add about 50 ml of water, and then with a small whisk, you whisk this batter until all the lumps are gone. So the batter should not be very watery, should not be very thick. Yes, it has to be of a very thin consistency. To the batter, we've added a few drops of pink food coloring. And then on a very hot non-stick pan, you pour the batter. Now the trick here is to not move or swirl the pan. Let it be the way it is. And the flame should be not very high, not very low. It should be on a medium level. So if you see here, the entire tui is crackling. Now that is basically the water bubbles, okay, which are crackling. And as soon as the water evaporates, it forms holes. And that's how you get that kind of a web structure of the tui. Once the crackling stops is when you know that the tui is done. So if you see here, okay, the tui has come off very easily from the pan. You can keep it on a paper napkin to soak off all the extra oil, and then you can store it in an airtight container. If the tui becomes soft, you can again reheat in a very low temperature pan to make it crisp. Next, moving on to another garnish, which is a parsley crisp. Okay, so for that we've just taken parsley leaves and kept them separated out on a baking tray. Here we are using a pie dish. Do not throw away the stems. The stems can be used to flavor stocks. Then we have some cherry tomatoes. The cherry tomatoes have been cut into half and placed on the same tray to save energy and to save time. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to put this tray inside a preheated oven at 100 degrees Celsius, 0% humidity for about 20 to 25 minutes until the parsley is completely dried up and the cherry tomatoes shrivel up. So if you see here, the cherry tomatoes are done. We are putting them in oil for a better texture and a longer shelf life. The parsley, if you see here, are completely dried up. Okay, so you can break them with your hands, crush them with your fingers, or use a rolling pin and then strain it through a sieve so that you get powdered parsley, which can be used to dust your presentation platter. Another way of making wrinkled or shriveled confit for garnish is you cut it into half, or you can keep the small ones whole and put them in olive oil or plain refined oil. Take a few pieces of whole garlic as well, and this entire mixture with oil is going to go on a tawa or a pan at a very very low heat, and heat this up to a temperature of between 60 and 70 degrees Celsius. This is called as confit, cherry tomato and garlic confit. Moving on to our next garnish, which is a Parmesan crisp. For that, you take about 2 tablespoons of Parmesan cheese in a bowl. In that, we are going to add little bit of water part by part, mix it to make it into a medium thick batter. For the first time, if you're making it, please add the water in part so that you get an idea of how your batter needs to be. So mix it with a spoon or a whisk until you get a thick batter. Then on a hot nonstick pan, put this mixture, about 2 tablespoons of the Parmesan cheese mixture. You can also put this in a ring mold to get a better shape, a better round shape. Then on a medium flame, again like your tuhi, don't move your pan, let the water evaporate, and the cheese then forms a webbed structure like this. Then with the help of a spatula, release the Parmesan crisp from the pan and turn it upside down and let it cook on the other side as well. So you see here, the Parmesan crisp is well cooked, turned slightly golden brown, and then it will become nice and crisp in about 10 seconds. This can again be stored in an airtight container. This Parmesan crisp can be broken into pieces, used for garnish, or can also be molded when hot into a cup shape and also can be used for presentation. Moving on to our next garnish, which are capsicum curls. So for that, we've taken colored capsicums, red and yellow. You can do this with green capsicum as well. So we've just taken a small piece of the capsicum. What we're doing here is we are taking out as much as the pith and the flesh of the capsicum. So we are really looking at the thinnest portion of the skin of the capsicum, and then with a very sharp knife you julienne the capsicum as thin as you can, really hair like thin strands of capsicum, and then keep them in cold water. Make sure when you're doing this you keep the capsicum curls in a very small diameter container so that they curl up even more. Keep this in the refrigerator for about 2 or 3 hours to curl up, and once you're curled up, you can squeeze out all the water from the capsicum curls and then use it for presentation. Next garnish are cucumber curls or cucumber rolls. So for that, you peel a cucumber and with a mandolin slicer or with a good quality peeler, you take thin, long slices of the cucumber and then cut them into about 1 centimeter wide long strips. Once you do that, then you tightly roll the cucumber curls, and then these can be used on the plate for presentation. Understand one thing, use garnishes that are very neutral and bland in flavor, because you do not want any dominance of flavor when you're using garnishes. So next we are going to make balsamic reduction. So for that, in a pan you take balsamic vinegar, in that optionally you can add some sugar and some red wine. Reduce this until it forms a thick syrupy kind of consistency liquid. This can cool down, and after it cools down it becomes even thicker and ready for presentation. So if you see here on a plate, we've taken a brush and we have brushed the balsamic reduction onto the plate. So here we are garnishing or we are decorating the plate, which is now ready for the other components of the dish to be placed. Moving on to the next garnish, which is tomato skin crisp. So for that, we are going to blanch the tomatoes. So like we all know, take out the eye of the tomato, make a crisscross at the back, and then blanch the tomatoes in hot boiling water for 20 seconds. Take the tomatoes out and refresh them in cold water, and then take out the skin with the help of a very sharp knife. After taking out the skin of the tomato, we will take out as much flesh as we can from the skin so that the skin dehydrates and gets crisp faster. After taking out the flesh, we will place these tomato skins on a greased steel plate or a steel lid, and then we will dehydrate this in a very low temperature preheated oven at 100 degrees Celsius, 0% humidity, for about 15 to 20 minutes. After they have got completely dried, we are then just going to shock them in hot oil so that the tomato skins become even more crispy and bright orange in color. These can now be used for garnish, or alternatively can also be crushed and can be used as a tomato powder or a tomato dust. Next garnish is fried leeks. So for that we just need to take the stalk of the leek. You can cut it into half or you can maintain the length of the leek. We'll divide the leek into half and make sure to clean the inner part of the leek. Then you thinly julienne the leek with a very, very sharp knife. And then to this thinly julienne leek, we are going to apply some salt so that the leeks ooze out as much moisture as it can and become nice and soft. So after about 10-15 minutes of the leek soaking the salt, you squeeze out all the moisture from the leek as much as you can and then loosen the leek strands out and dust them with some refined flour. You can also use corn flour and then coat each and every strand of the leek with the refined flour. In hot oil, add all the flour coated leek and then fry it. Again, the oil should not be very hot, otherwise the leeks are going to turn brown at once, which we don't want. So the oil should not be very hot, should not be at a very low temperature as well. So you see here we use the web fryer or the web strainer to fry the leeks, so the leeks stay in one place. Keep removing the fryer from the oil to avoid browning of the leeks. And if you see here, the leeks are very, very well fried, crisp, not brown. And this can be used now as a garnish on top of a meat or on top of a fish for presentation. Moving on to our next garnish, which are fried mushroom slices or mushroom crisps. So for that we peel the mushroom with a sharp knife and then with the help of a mandolin, or you can even use your knife if you don't have a mandolin, and slice the mushroom into very, very thin slices, as thin as you can. To these mushroom slices we are now going to add some salt. So arrange the mushroom slices onto a plate and then apply some salt to it. Let this stand for about 5 to 10 minutes until all the moisture draws out of the mushroom. Then you dry out the mushroom very, very carefully with the help of a paper napkin. And then you dust every slice of mushroom with some refined flour. Since the slices are very thin, you might end up slightly breaking the mushroom, which is fine because the mushroom are anyways going to shrink and become into a very, very small size after frying. So you dip every slice of mushroom in flour and you fry it at once in hot oil. So because of the moisture loss, the mushrooms shrink, they shrivel and they turn nice and brown and crispy, and they look like small petals or shriveled leaves. So they look nice on the plate. They give a slight umami flavor to your entire dish and gives an element of crunch. So take the fried mushrooms out. Again, they can be stored in an airtight container, but the best is to use these mushroom slices fresh. So you fry them and they can be used as a garnish. Next, we are going to make some bacon crisp and bacon soil. So for that, we take really thin slices of belly bacon or streaky bacon and put them on a greased plate. Put another greased plate on top of it with some weight on top, and this goes inside a 180 degree heated oven for about 20 to 25 minutes. So once that is done, you take the upper lid out, and if you see here, the bacon has got nice and crisp and dark brown colored. So you take out the crisp gently. This crisp can be used whole on top of a dish, just to again to give height to the dish, to add to the color and a texture to your entire dish. So we really have thin slices of bacon crisp which can be used as a garnish, or you can also break down these crisps into a soil. So you finely chop the fried bacon and convert that into a crumb which resembles and looks like soil. So that also can be used as a part of your plate presentation. So that's bacon soil and that's crispy bacon. Moving on to our next garnish, that's basil oil. So for that we need nice bright green colored soft basil leaves. We're going to blanch them in hot water for exactly 10 seconds and then we shock the basil leaves in cold water. We are doing this for the basil leaves to get even softer but yet maintain the green color. So you shock it in cold water at once, then you'll squeeze out all the water from the basil and then add it into a mixer jar. In that we are going to add in a neutral colored and flavored oil and then blend it into a very very fine and smooth paste, and then with the help of a muslin cloth we will sieve or we will strain this mixture until the solids remain back in the muslin cloth and the oil drains out into the bowl. So there we have an extremely flavorful and a good colored green basil oil, and you can store that in a squeezy bottle like this and use it for presentation or drizzle it on some salad. Moving on to our next garnish, which is basil crisp or fried basil. So for that you simply need fresh leaves of basil and you have to fry them in hot oil. Make sure the temperature of the oil is not very hot, otherwise the basil leaves will turn brown. So simply fry them in oil and use them as a garnish. So next we are going to make some dehydrated garlic chips. So for that we've taken peeled garlic, sliced them thinly and placed them on a greased steel plate or a steel lid. This will go inside a preheated oven at 100 degrees Celsius for about 30 to 45 minutes until they become nice and crisp. So if you see here, we've set the humidity level to 0% and we've placed the garlic chips inside the oven. And you see the final product here, you have nice golden brown dehydrated crisp slices of garlic. We are now going to make some edible foam. So starting with the water-based foam, so here I've taken water. You can replace this water with a nice flavorful stock. So that's about 250 ml of water. Okay, in that we've added around 30 ml of soy sauce here for flavor and for color. Then in that we are going to add very little soy lecithin powder. So the proportion usually is about 0.6 to 1% of the liquid. Then you take a whisk and you whisk this to take out all the lumps of the soy lecithin. Then what you do is you take a small immersion blender or a milk frother like this, and then you keep blending this mixture until you create air bubbles, and then this will create a foam or stabilized foam. So because of the soy lecithin, the foam is stabilized and stays for a longer time. So this will take about 1 to 2 minutes of blending. So you see here the foam has been formed on top, and then you can use this foam now for presentation. These foams that we make with the help of soy lecithin, because there is an additional protein, it emulsifies and really stabilizes the foam, and these foams stay for a very long time. Moving on to a milk-based foam, so you take again the same quantity, around 250 ml of warm milk. In that we are going to add again a little bit of soy lecithin powder, whisk it again to remove lumps. If there are any lumps which are not getting dissolved by the whisk, then you can strain the milk, and then using the same milk frother you create bubbles and you create foam in the milk. Again this will take around 2 to 3 minutes for the milk to form the foam. And then again, similarly, like the water-based foam, you can use this milk foam to garnish dishes like soups. Moving on to an oil-based foam, again, same process. You take oil. In that we are going to add a little bit of soy lecithin powder. Only here you have to heat this oil and lecithin mixture to about 60 degree Celsius, and then you put the milk frother or the immersion blender, and then you blend this until you get a nice stabilized foam. So this will also take about 1 to 2 minutes of blending, and then you get a very nice stabilized foam. So look at that, that's a very well formed foam. So then again, you can use this as a part of your plate presentation or as a garnish on top of any dish. So these are basically three types of foam that we have shown you using soy lecithin. So this is the water based foam, then we have the milk based foam, and then we have the oil based foam. Moving on to edible flowers. Now it's very difficult to grow edible flowers through seeds because they need a certain kind of a weather and soil, but you really get edible flowers from the market. They're difficult to procure, but if you pre-order, you can get a set of different edible flowers. So what we see here are different kinds of pansies. Next, what we have over here are nasturtium, so they can be of different colors. Then we have borage, which are these delicate blue colored flowers. So those tiny little purple flowers are violas. So you really can get a variety of edible flowers from the market. You can use chamomile, you can use tomato, you can use cilantro flowers. So you can use a couple of these edible flowers as a part of your plate presentation. So these are a few garnishes that we have shown you all. So either you can use a single garnish or you can use a couple of garnishes on a plate, as long as there is a balance of color, texture and height, and it should complement the main flavor of your dish.